Catherine Coos, Laurel Hill, Spotsylvania County. Dilapidation and decay mark the course of everything here. Both people and place are gradually falling into ruins. An air of suffocating loneliness reigns. As the shades of evening come on, the wind has a peculiar howling sound, as if ghosts and witches were around mourning over the sad remains. There is no peace in living in this godforsaken country. We are suffering from such lawless times as existed in the Dark Ages.
Begun as a war to restore the Union, the Civil War became a struggle to transform a nation. In that struggle, no community suffered more than this one, the town of Fredericksburg, Virginia, and the adjacent counties of Stafford and Spotsylvania. For most of 4 years, armies blue and gray traversed, occupied, or fought over this ground. Through it all, civilians waged a battle of their own for survival, for dignity, and for freedom. 25,000 people lived here, half slave, half free. This is their story, told in their own words.
I, John Washington, was born in Fredericksburg, Virginia, May 20th, 1838. A slave to one Thomas R. Ware, Sr. My mother struggled hard, late and early, to get a poor pittance for the children. I was dressed every morning in a neat white apron and clean jacket and pants, and sent up to see what mistress might want me to do. I would be ordered to sit down on a footstool in her room for hours at a time, when other children of my age would be out at play.
You're supposed to be working on that fence tomorrow, ain't you?
Every Sunday morning, the week's rations were issued from the great meat house.
How's your boy doing?
He's fine.
Is he ready to work?
Yes, sir.
All right.
At Christmas, the slaves were given their new cloth, hats, boots, and flour, sugar, whiskey, and molasses. And then we would go to our cabins and for the next 6 days have a holiday and make things lively with eggnog, opossum, rabbit, coon, and everything of the kind.
I want to make an oratory.
All right, go ahead.
I want to take time and thank the Lord above.
All right.
This was a blessed and happy land in my boyhood and youth. All the rich bottom lands of the Rappahannock were occupied by prosperous planters whose ample estates with their spacious residence had descended for generations from father to son.
Have I told you my theory pertaining to new modes of travel, Trent? I rather thought I had.
Yes.
These homes were then the abode of great comfort and dignity. A generous and elegant hospitality was universal. The house servants were long and carefully trained in their respective duties, and often remained for generations in the same families. Dabney, Herndon, Maury.
Well, a certain element perhaps, but not the Northwest variety, surely. I don't really regard them as Northern, do you? Westerners are very
different. Step up, gentlemen. 17 valuable slaves, consisting of men, women, and children. One promising boy. We also have a woman and 5 children. What have I been?
We were at dinner when I heard that my cook's husband had been sold and he had come to take leave of his wife. When I got into the yard, he was standing there heavily handcuffed. I shall never forget the silent agony of his looks as he cast his eyes on the irons on his wrist. They seemed to have entered into his soul.
Please.
I offered to let Jane be sold to go with him that they might not be separated. But the man who acted as agent for the trader told me candidly that that would not secure the end I desired, for they would be sold wherever they got the highest price for them.
No, I'm sorry.
When all was ready, he turned and said in a steady voice to the white man, Now, I am ready to go. His poor wife is almost heartbroken, for there is no probability of their meeting again in this world. The frequency of these sales, and above all, the deadening effects of slavery upon the feelings, have steeled the hearts of our people to its enormity. Mary Minor Blackford.
The situation of Fredericksburg is beautiful and healthful. The town is alive and growing. New houses are going up and manufacturers starting into life.
One moment. I have
on William Street, where large crops are bought and large supplies of merchandise laid in, you see at the corners groups of merchants and farmers discussing things in general and talking of crops, droughts, groceries, and the tightness of the market. The family stocks in Fredericksburg are, in talent, genius, and morality, far above the average. DuBose Review, 1860.
Johnny.
When I was 11, I began to see some of the many trials of slavery. The master came to the conclusion that mother, with my sisters and brother, would have to be sent to Stanton, Virginia, to be hired.
But, Mama, when you coming back for me?
I was to be kept in hand by the old mistress for a special use. The night before Mother left me, she came up to my little room in the white people's house and laid down on my bed by me. She begged me to try and be a good boy, say my prayers every night, remember all she had tried to teach me, and always think of her. Her tears mingled with mine amidst kisses and heartfelt sorrow. She tucked a bedcloth around me and bade me good night.
Now promise me you're gonna be a good boy.
Bitter pangs filled my heart, and I thought I would rather die.
I hate them, Mama. I hate them white people to take you away. No, baby.
Then and there, my hatred was kindled secretly against my oppressors.
The Lord don't want you to.
And I promised myself if ever I got an opportunity, I would run away from the devilish slaveholders.
The Constitution was made for one people. The two sections are two peoples. Just as we Americans proclaimed our independence from Britain, we as Southern men establish and will defend our right of independence from the Union.
We, the ladies of Fredericksburg and the vicinities, firmly believe the course pursued by Virginia has been ever true and just.
And these dear souls, that is, her husbands and sons, are sacrificing for hearth and home. I propose that we agree to submit to any privations our men and our rulers may direct.
I know that each of you will do your full duty to Virginia and to the Confederacy.
As the war entered its second year in April 1862, Union troops arrived opposite Fredericksburg for the first time. They would occupy the town peacefully for 4 months. Though a few Unionists quietly greeted the Federal Army, most white residents took offense at the Union occupation and resisted fiercely through gesture and attitude.
You don't understand us.
For many slaves in Fredericksburg, Stafford, and Spotsylvania, the occupation meant opportunity. Though not all soldiers in the Union Army welcomed them, thousands of slaves fled into Union lines to freedom and an uncertain future.
Helen Bernard, Beaumont, Spotsylvania County, Good Friday, 1862. It is heart-sickening to think of having our beautiful valley that we have so loved and admired all overrun and desolated by our bitter enemies, whose sole object is to subjugate and plunder the South.
April 18th, 1862 was Good Friday, and everything unusually quiet
there they is.
Until everybody was startled by several reports of Yankee cannon. In less time than it takes me to write these lines, every white man was out of the house. But every man's servant was out on the house top looking over the river at the Yankees, for their glistening bayonets could easily be seen.
We feel that we are for the present a conquered people. The flag that we have learned to love and know as a symbol of resistance to oppression no longer waves over us, and in its stead we have the now hated Stars and Stripes.
I could not begin to express my newborn hopes, for I felt like I was certain of my freedom now.
Okay, soldiers, ma'am, could you hold on till I take my image, please? You're gonna have to handle.
We Confederates are, generally speaking, the most cheerful people imaginable. But we treat the Yankees with silent contempt.
Ma'am, did I not ask you kindly to wait before you walk through?
Ah, they little know the hatred in our hearts towards them. I never hear or see a federal private or officer riding down the street that I don't wish his neck may be broken before he crosses the bridge.
Lizzie also.
Escaped slaves absolutely swarm in the city. They're universally struck with surprise at being treated like men instead of chattel. The presence of our troops here has placed the slave owners of the vicinity in an awkward dilemma. Dr. Morrison, who lives near here, informed me today that he cannot get any work out of his slaves whatever, as they tell him that now they are free, and that they will hire themselves to him for wages, but will no longer work for nothing.
I was in company with my first cousin James and a free colored man.
Hello over there!
We walked down to the river.
Hello there!
A party of soldiers called out to us. Do any of you want to come across? I hollered out.
Yes! We wants to come across!
Make me dot the landing!
After I had landed on the other side, a large crowd of the soldiers gathered around us and asked all kinds of questions. I told them I was most happy to see them all, that I had been looking for them for a long time. Just then, one of them asked me if I was a slave. Yes, sir, I am, I replied, a slave all my life. Do you want to be free, inquired one? By all means, I answered. I did not know what else to say, for I was dumb with joy and could only thank God and laugh. This was my first night of my freedom.
Much obliged.
June 22nd, 1862.
The town is intensely Yankee and looks as though it had never been anything else.
New York Herald!
Yankee newsboys cry Yankee papers along the streets.
Cumberland Confectioners, what happened to Mr. Heineken's establishment?
Oh, I'm sure I can't say, but we do have some.
Yankee citizens and Yankee Dutchmen have opened all the stores on Main Street.
It's all perfectly legal.
Yankee legal.
September 1st, 1862. Having stolen all the Negroes and things they could move, the Union Army left, illuminating their retiring villainy by burning bridges, bakeries, depots, and camps. The flames, the water, the illumination, the trees, and the dark night together made a splendid celebration of the restored independence of the subjugated Confederates.
Poor creatures. They have seen but little of the horrors of war. If they ever really do see war, they will sigh for the times they are now passing through. General John Gibbon, USA.
The Union Army returned again to Fredericksburg in November 1862, this time not to occupy, but to fight. Residents became refugees as thousands fled to farms and churches in Spotsylvania County. For 5 days in mid-December, Fredericksburg lay at the mercy of battling armies.
November 21st, 1862. I, as a mayor child, will never forget that day. I was talking to a child friend when a shell went over our heads and fell at the back gate of my home. I was thoroughly alarmed and ran into the house. I was too young to entirely appreciate the situation, as my parents and sisters did. But I will never forget their faces. They were all so shocked. But they soon went to work with determination, putting together all kinds of necessary articles. Mary Campbell Knox.
November 25th, 1862. Generals Lee, Jackson, Longstreet are all here. We are surrounded with soldiers and camps and all the paraphernalia of war. It is so exciting, and our feelings are so above the ordinary ones that we can't tell whether it's pleasant or the contrary. Citizens are moving and counter-moving, dying to avoid the Yankees.
Girls, girls, we need to go.
For scarcely anyone who remained with them last summer was willing to stay again.
Where are we going? Why are we leaving? The Yankees are here.
It was a pitiable sight to see women and children streaming along the roads. Nothing in the world but what they have on their backs. I do believe, after all that I have seen, that I could murder the Blue Devils in cold blood. Benjamin Stiles, CSA.
December 11. At 5:30, I am awakened by the boom of two heavy guns. The Yankees are shelling the town.
We rushed into our basement for safety. On the first landing, I remembered Julian, my sick boy, and turned back to seek him. I met him half-dressed with his clothes upon his arm and tried to help him. But I was trembling so violently that I believe I was more indebted to him for assistance than he was to me. Jane Beale.
A big shell passed through the dining room, knocking off one leg of the table from which we had just risen.
Beside our own family of 10, several poor outcasts had sought shelter with us.
John!
In the further corner, where the candle flickered and burned, a poor, half-witted woman crouched, hugging her knees as she rocked to and fro, exclaiming, "Oh, my son John! Oh, John! If only I knew where he was!" Mamie Wells.
The Lord is my light and my salvation.
It is curious. Since that day's bombardment only killed of the population one white man and one colored woman. And during the day, Mrs. Hugh Scott gave birth in her shell-riddled house to a little girl. Afterwards, always going by the nickname of Shell Baby.
Hearing the sound of musketry close at hand, I stepped into an adjoining cellar in order to hear more distinctly. At that moment, a squad of men came rushing down the street, uttering fearful oaths about the rebels. The order was given to fire. A volley of musketry and heart-rending death cry from a southern officer followed. Though the shelling had been fearful and had lasted many hours, it had not unnerved me. But the poor human cry pierced my very heart.
December 13, 1862, the armies clashed on the plains beyond Fredericksburg. Afterwards, the town lay ravaged, bombarded, looted, forever scarred.
Wednesday, December 17th. I went to Fredericksburg on this raw and cold day. Oh, what a scene of desolation. Dead horses and mules. Under Sister Charlotte's chamber window lay a dead Yankee, died as he fell, for he was on his face. A party of our soldiers with perfect unconcern were laughing and eating in another part of the yard. I saw dead Yankees everywhere.
One of our rooms was piled more than halfway to the ceiling, with feathers from beds ripped open. Every mirror had been run through with the bayonet, a panel of each door cut out, furniture nearly all broken up, the china broken to bits, and everything of value taken away. Fanny White.
Ghastly was the numbers of amputated limbs found. A number of houses were burned down. Many more made untenable by shot and shell. Hardly one having escaped entirely.
How's your house, Edward?
Shot through. Shelled. Like this one. Like all the others.
There's a few stores that did business for the spoil of their contents. But for all this loss, we considered ourselves amply repaid when we viewed the thousands of enemy corpses upon the battlefield. E. L. Heineken.
For civilians here, the Battle of Fredericksburg marked the beginning of a 2-year struggle for survival and dignity amidst war. The constant presence of armies left the landscape treeless and food for civilians scarce. Farming and commerce came to a virtual halt.
Some of the inhabitants returned and made such repairs as was in their limited power. I went to housekeeping. That is, I bought a bed and rocking chair from Mrs. Fitzgerald. For our meals, I clubbed together with Mr. John G. Herkamp. We spent the days hunting amongst the ruins for such articles as we absolutely needed.
Aha! I found it!
What?
My cross key! The devil's...
I recollect Mr. Herkamp searching a long time, but with final success for a key to wind up his clock, which miraculously escaped destruction.
I wonder what time it is, Edward.
Time, John? I wonder what day it is.
February 1863. My house is now thoroughly entrenched. The whole front yard is a deep pit. Our own troops are plundering and defiling every house in town. The conduct of our soldiers is most disgraceful. Those residents who left have lost everything. Douglas Gordon.
Stafford County. Few slaves are left, and the pampered, petted, arid, aristocratic children of slaveholders have now to earn their bread by the sweat of their brow.
I'm sorry, Miss Bartlett.
Letty, oh my word, not you!
I have thought very much of the slavery question since I have been in a country where it is tolerated, and I have finally come to the conclusion that God has set his finger of disapprobation upon the institution, and that it must fall and be remembered only as a relic of barbarism.
If they didn't feel compelled, they would not be leaving. Please, let me speak with them.
All right, ma'am. I'll give you 5 minutes.
I have noticed that however well a slave was treated, or however well they love their masters, their dream of liberty in almost every case lends enchantment to a place north of Mason and Dixon's line.
Goodbye, Miss Bartlett. I'll be praying for you every night.
Colonel Elijah C. Cavins, 14th Indiana.
There is no encouragement here to try to do anything. Not long since our last horse was stolen from us. It is too bad. Horses, like everything else in Dixie, are so scarce and high we do not think of trying to get another. I have felt for a long time that we have had just as much of the disagreeables of this life as we well could. Catherine Coos, Laurel Hill, Spotsylvania County.
The struggles of winter gave way to springtime battles in 1863 and 1864. Chancellorsville. Wilderness. Spotsylvania Courthouse. Spotsylvanians saw their farm fields turn to killing fields, their homes to hospitals. For civilians, it was a kaleidoscope of horrors that would take decades to overcome.
Ooh. Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, heavy fighting was kept up, and we had to stay in the basement all the time without a mouthful to eat, or a spark of fire, or a ray of light.
I'll bring you some water.
Oh, it did my soul so much good to see the Yanks skedaddle. They have a number of killed and wounded now lying on the field. One old dead one is lying behind our barn, and you can see them everywhere you go.
We've seen you coming through here for more than a week now.
We have 4 we attend to out on the field. They cannot live, but still, we cannot let them suffer.
Well, I won't be damning you.
I have said I never would do an act of kindness for one of them to save their lives. But I feel altogether different when I see them suffering.
Surgeon's table in the house immediately, quickly.
My memories of May 1864 are awful.
It's a flash wound. Take him over.
All of the houses in town were taken possession of by the Federal soldiers to be used as hospitals for their wounded. We could hear the roaring of cannons all day long from our front porch, and then the ambulances were coming in by the hundreds, filled with wounded. The streets were so blocked that no one could possibly pass between them. The groans and moans of the wounded were something terrible. I cannot find words to express how terrible it was. Our house had a good many officers in it. Our parlor was filled. Mary Campbell Knox.
March 3rd, 1865. We, the women of the South, can only wait, watch, and pray. Scarcely can we realize that Sherman has overrun Georgia, South Carolina, and is even now advancing with rapid strides through the old Tar State. Yet we know that with God's help, we shall be victorious.
The Confederacy collapsed in April 1865, leaving this community to reckon with a wartime ordeal that transformed it.
We are a ruined people. Old Spotsylvania is laid waste. Our public and private property destroyed. I've lost all of my best labor teams, utensils, and provisions. All the earnings of my life. And my dear John Mercer, my second son, who was killed defending his native soil. The Confederacy has fallen, and the whole estate is not worth 1 cent to any of us. We have lost all with the Confederacy. J.W. Waller.
As their troops pass by, hour after hour, our hearts sink within us to think that they are going home triumphantly, while we have lost all. Oh, it is very hard to endure such misery patiently. I cannot feel reconciled. My heart is so rebellious that instead of forgiving our enemies, I hate them more every hour of my life.
A most memorable night was when the soldiers assured me that I was now a free man. Before morning, I had begun to feel like I had truly escaped from the hands of my slave masters, and with the help of God, I would never be a slave no more. I felt for the first time in my life I could now claim every cent that I should work for as my own. Life had a new joy awaiting me.
After the war, Fredericksburg, Stafford, and Spotsylvania sought normalcy once more. Though residents would eventually reclaim the slow rhythms of small-town life, in fact, little here would ever be the same. For former slaves, war meant the beginning of a journey into freedom, a quest for legal and social equality that would span generations. Residents, black and white, rebuilt, and over time, Fredericksburg, Spotsylvania, and Stafford heal. Today, this region's searing experience during the Civil War remains central to its identity.
For so persecuted they, the prophets which were before you.
Today we're going to read a book called Civil War on Sunday.
Its experiences teach us of determination and resilience. Its places remind us of past struggles, and its people carry a legacy of healing and freedom.